Well, I'm going to go ahead and get started. So it is 7:01 by my clock, and I just want to thank everyone for being here today, being in our room. My name is Melinda McCrary, and I am the Executive Director of the Richmond Museum of History and Culture, and I am delighted to welcome you to our Zoom room to discuss, to have Scott Haskins of Fine Arts Conservation Lab discuss the restoration and treatment of Richmond Industrial City by Victor Arnautoff. And just a little bit of background on the mural. The mural was painted in 1941 and it hung in the Richmond Post Office until 1976. At which time the post office was renovated and the mural was removed from the wall and it was put on a tube and it was created and put in the basement of the post office. The post office lost track of it. And after a series of unlikely events, the Richmond Museum took possession of it in 2015. It took us a little while to raise the funds to restore the mural because we're quite a small museum and organization. But we are proud to have done that. Myself and my team, including I see Steve Guilford here, who is my one on my board, and my community engagement manager, Evelyn Santos, is part of my team. And also Doug Harris is a great filmmaker who helps us out a lot. So this was a community effort. And we were able to engage Scott Haskins to work on the mural for us. I'm just delighted to have the opportunity to have him tonight. We're recording this as well so that we can put it to the general public. It can be watched again. But without any more further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Scott.
Well, thanks. It's really a pleasure to be here with everybody tonight. And it's going to be, I hope, something that you will not have heard anyplace else. If you are, if you're into the history of the Bay Area, this will certainly fit into that. But also just generally for WPA art and art history and murals and architecture. And, you know, there are several ways that this could be appealing to you. I think that the interest is could be really widespread. The thing that's interesting to me is I keep learning. In fact, I just before we got started here, I just learned another tidbit, and that is the artist was extremely well connected. He was a protege of Diego Rivera, Melinda was telling me that he was a student of Diebenkorn. I mean, like, talk. And he was the director of artist. He was the artistic director for the murals in Coit Tower in San Francisco. So this guy wasn't a newbie. He wasn't just kind of very very well considered and in the prime of his abilities. So are there any questions to start off with before I kind of jump into this? I have a PowerPoint presentation. I'm going to speak for about 20 minutes. Then we'll give some more, if you've got some questions, I can answer those for you. During this 20 minutes, I'm going to show you a video that I've put together of the restoration process. So, any questions to start out with?
Just help if you give me the dimensions of the mural.
So the dimension about 6.5 by 13.5 feet, 6.5 feet high. It says 6.5 feet high, but when you're standing in front of it, it looks a lot bigger. It looks like it's more like 8 by 15 or more. So, but it fills a wall in the museum very nicely. And that's going to look bigger because they need to put a molding around the outside of it, around the border of it, to kind of close in some corners, some edges. So, all right. So I am going to now take over the screen. Let's see, share screen. And I am going to, bam. Is that what I'm doing? Can everybody see my screen?
Yeah.
And that works. Yes. And we're going to go like that. So does everybody see that all right?
Yeah.
All right, good. So anyway, we are, of course, at the Richmond Museum of History and Culture. And one of the questions that I get often is, how did I get into art restoration? How did I start working on doing mural conservation and mural restoration? And that was decades ago in northern Italy. In the north, there's a big lake called Garda Lake. And on one side of Garda Lake is Verona. And on the other side, on the west side of the lake, is Brescia. And there is a regional art conservation center there that is in this 800-year-old monastery that's been turned into very, very high-end scientific labs. And this was the first mural that I ever worked on. It was dated 1365. And these are not murals of African-Americans. These were white white pigmented figures, and then the lead-based paint changed color with the pollution of the area in the air. Anyway, this is the central area of the old church and the entrance to the labs. And this is one of the churches that I worked in northern Italy. You can see I got a good start on quality projects with really high quality people that worked internationally in the jungles of Burma and in the pyramids of Egypt. They were I went through a 3-year conservation program. And so it was really a great thing. But coming back to the United States, obviously going to work on very many, Renaissance frescoes. So anyway, one of the areas of work that we had over the years has been with the art around World War II, sometimes called regionalism or modernism, and sometimes inappropriately they call it WPA art. And so you can see here that the mural came into the lab, and we were inspecting it, looking over the different parts. So we've worked on WPA art my entire career. These murals here are in the City Hall in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. And we took off, I think it was like 4 or 6 layers of paint. They were painted out because at a certain point, politically, socially, they became objectionable. And then they regained regain their favor, and so they we were in charge of uncovering them.
They have 2 in the closet.
Oh yeah,
mm-hmm, there's 2.
So let's see, Laura Flores, looks like can you mute your sound, please? Are you there, Laura?
Yes.
Yeah, there you go. If anybody has any noise going on around, to make sure you're muted. In Fair Park, Dallas, Texas, there are thousands and thousands of square feet of murals from Depression era. And Carlos Ciampaglia was an Italian American that painted murals there, and we've uncovered acres of them. This used to all be painted out with 6 layers of paint over it, and we uncovered it. And they are really, really beautiful, very stylistic. So here we are about 60 feet in the air. These murals, as you can see, are huge, and they're everywhere. So I just got a call from the city of Dallas, and they're looking to begin another phase of it, and they're wanting to get back into it. So I maybe I'm hoping that pretty soon I'm hard to find and that I'll be in Dallas quite a bit, because it was a great project. Anyway, one project that we just finished, like within the last 30 or 60 days, was The History of Ranching in Texas by Buck Wynn. And we did, and these murals were like yours, ripped out of a building unceremoniously, unprofessionally, damaging the murals quite a bit. But then later on, they were donated to Texas State University, and we brought them back together in the exact same way that we did with your mural and mounted it. And here you can see, this is exactly the same thing we did to yours. Yours used to have distortions in it, and the white that you see on the back is a lead, is a toxic lead white material that was used as an adhesive. And here we are taking care of that. Julie Stevenson is actually an art conservator that worked with me and worked in Dallas, Texas with me for years. And she is now working with us in Santa Barbara and helped us put the final touches on your mural. Anyway, one of the things that we did with the History of Ranching was to put them on a movable backing like we did yours. And the motivation for mounting your mural, which is a painting on canvas that Arnautoff then glued to the wall. And then when the renovation of the post office took place, they took the edge of the canvas and ripped it off the wall, which of course caused the paint to shatter and go crazy. And so we stabilized everything and then mounted it to this stiffer material to give it some backing. And we did that for a seismic or an earthquake proofing process. Interestingly enough, we had a bit of a shock in Santa Barbara today with an earthquake. Anyway, here we are backing the very large, the 90 feet of Buck Wynn murals that we worked on. And here they are mounted onto their provisional wall that actually got raised up to the ceiling. It was really kind of a weird, kind of a cool time machine thing. This History of Ranching and these old vintage murals were up above everybody. And then down below were all the computer stations where all the technology and stuff was going on. So there was this huge contrast of technology and history and people's attitudes and what they were thinking about, you know, and it was kind of a, gave it some thought, it kind of set you off. Anyway, here you go with the border around it, hiding the edge. You can see that Melinda there. See how they put the edge around there to hide the edge of the fabric where we bolted it in. And then they put some nice lights on it and bam, it's fantastic. Anyway, here we are at the, this is the photograph of the post office with the portrait of Arnautoff. And you all know, or many of you know, that the there was a population boom of Richmond and the area when they opened up the shipyards for World War II. And of course, in 1931, Ford set up a manufacturing plant. So there was all kinds of equipment, supplies, things being produced and manufactured there. And the population in this town in from 1940 to 1944 went from 25,000 to 100,000 people in 4 years. And in the middle of this expansion and this focus and the money coming in and the importance put on this area, Arnautoff was contracted to put in this mural. And of course, the post office is probably one of the focal areas of a community back then. You couldn't just hit email and send. So everybody was going to the post office. And so it was a very, very visible, very, very, I think an important work of public art. So here we are, you can see that there is a Model A here. This was the first Model A off the production line in 1931. And it actually belonged to and was driven by one of the guys in the mural. And you know, this is not the original home of the mural. So the fact that we brought the mural to this location, that Melinda aligned the stars, and all of a sudden the mural with the guy in it is next to his car. It's crazy. Anyway, we've worked, of course, on many post office WPA projects before, but the lead white on the back was something that we wanted to take care of because that had a toxic element to it that we've taken care of many, 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 many times before and has zero toxicity now for the public and zero risk for anyone in the room or the building. It's not at all similar to anything like asbestos where people go nuts just hearing the word. This is not at all the same thing. So here we are preparing the mural for the backing, as I told you before. And you can see around the edges of the backing that's now attached to the mural, you can see that there are grommets where we bolt this stiff material to the wall. And then of course, as the building begins to shake or crack or break, this will not be wrecked with the building if it were to go through a big earthquake. And I've seen many murals completely destroyed. In fact, I have a mural in our lab that was badly destroyed and knocked off the wall from an earthquake, obviously being glued to the wall. So the seismic protection was one of the reasons that we decided on this method of mounting it to this material and then bolting it to the wall. You would think that as a mural, you would just kind of re-glue it up like a piece of wallpaper. But some of you may remember the shake that we had in the Marina District some years ago. And so you're definitely in an earthquake zone, and I'm feeling really good about the long-term preservation possibilities for your mural. So it takes a team, of course. I was not the lone wolf that was working on this, but Virginia Panazon behind me there, and Julianne Stevenson there. And then we have an office manager, we have a conservation technician, another art conservator helped us on the project. And so there's always a process, but with a team. There are a couple of important aspects to art conservation as a profession. And a lot of people think that it's just kind of, well, you know, you gotta just kind of restore it, make it look good. And that's not at all what we do. We have to understand why things fall apart. We have to understand if we put something on it, like some glue or some adhesive or something, as that deteriorates and ages, is that going to cause the artwork to fall apart? In other words, we look at artwork in terms of centuries. And you can imagine that if you put something on the artwork that fell apart and then you couldn't get it off of the artwork, as it falls apart, it'd take the artwork with it. And so the part of the process is understanding the materials that we use. We understand how they fall apart. They've been artificially and naturally aged and researched. And we go through a process called reversibility, which is at some point, it may not be a natural disaster that causes us to have to undo the restoration. It might be a fire. And fire in a building, and then you've got to undo some things in order to get back to the sweet spot in restoring and preserving and restoring the artwork. So you can see here on his hat, he's flaking. If we were to just actually, this is interesting. The restorer that took this off the wall from the post office did a horrific amount of damage to it when they yanked the canvas off of the wall. And they just stressed the paint a lot. And then to cover up their damage that they did so that they wouldn't, to make a good impression on their client or the owner, they repainted lots of different areas of the mural. And in fact, the entire face of this African-American is repainted. And it is still flaking. And now we have to take off the repainting because the areas are discoloring around it. And in other areas, the repainting has discolored so it doesn't match the right color. And in addition, it's still flaking and we can't get to the flaking with the retouching on it. It's a huge mess. And so anyway, I'll show you what that looks like later. Here, this shows a cleaning spot and taking the grime and the yellow varnish off, and the liveliness of the real color underneath was wonderful. And then here is, let me show you quickly then, let's see here. Stop sharing this, okay. Bam, and start sharing this, okay. And start sharing.
We bring you a heartening and upbeat story of saving, preserving, and restoring quality public heritage, an almost 100-year-old WPA mural important to the history of the Bay Area and World War II pride. Melinda McCrary, Executive Director of the Richmond Museum of History and Culture, has found the resources to save, protect, and restore an abandoned, lost mural in storage which was removed from a post office in the 1970s. The excellent quality, modernist style mural was originally painted as a project of the Works Project Administration in 1941 by Russian immigrant artist Victor Arnautoff. My name is Scott Haskins, and I'm with Fine Art Conservation Laboratories. We were honored to be the art conservation team for this project. We have extensive experience both with restoration of WPA art and with projects containing lead toxic materials. The rough removal of the mural from the wall of the post office almost 50 years ago set into motion a very difficult flaking problem. Yellowed varnish and grime dulled the colors substantially and change the colors of the original painting. Toxic lead materials were removed and encapsulated in order to make them 100% safe. The backing material to strengthen the original painting and the mounting technique were decided upon considering that we live in earthquake country and that a seismic precaution was important. After all the components of the mural were stabilized for long-term preservation, then the inpainting or restoration process began. This is undertaken with colors that are reversible or can be removed easily in the future without damaging the original paint. A small brush is used to only dot in color where it is missing. This is Virginia Panazon, and she is one of the art conservators working on the project. Virginia, the initial varnish that we put on the mural, tell me a little bit about that.
Well, the initial varnish that we use is designed specifically to get the best color saturation, and it is brush applied. We apply it, brushing it in multiple directions to make sure that it is well absorbed into the paint.
So is this varnish something you can go down to the store and buy?
No, it's a special order. It's designed especially for conservation because it can be removed very easily in the future with very lightweight solvents. It's designed to be on the paint layer because it is the best varnish to be easily removed and gives the best clarity to the colors as well.
Okay, so the final varnish that you have, you're all decked out for there. What's that all about?
This is the final varnish that we put on. We've decided to go with a semi-gloss, so not a super gloss and not a dead matte, but somewhere on the spectrum in between.
Well, what would it have looked like back in the 1940s?
I believe it would have looked this way. It would have looked
so, and why are you spray applying it?
And we can get the best even coat
So how many layers of varnish do you put on this?
Well, seeing that we spray them on, they're very fine layers. So we probably put about 6 layers of varnish on.
The galleries where the mural will be located set the perfect stage for the presentation of this mural. We enlisted the help of lots of volunteers that were anxious to help and were very good at following directions. The mural went up without a hitch and was bolted to the wall as planned. After the installation, that gave us an opportunity to do some fine tuning, touch up a little bit of varnish, and to dial it in to perfection. This is the very happy resolving of difficult problems for a quality mural that deserved much more respect. At least you would have thought so, given that Victor Arnautoff was the artistic director of the extensive murals at Coit Tower in San Francisco and a protégé of the superstar artist Diego Rivera. Congratulations to Richmond Museum of History and Culture for your exceptional vision, contributions to your community, and for your cultural integrity. We from Fine Art Conservation Laboratories are proud to have been part of this very positive, socially conscious art preservation and mural restoration of the history and legacy of this area for generations to come.
All right, here we go. Bam. Is everybody still with me?
Yeah.
Still trying. I think we're.
Thank you so much, Scott. That was wonderful.
I'm still trying to figure out how we move forward and finish off the slides from the. Maybe I pushed that button right there. Whoops. Oh, maybe that's the way you do it. Okay. So anyway, we are very excited. Oh, is that me? Okay. Anyway, we're thankful and proud to be part of this project, and we're very happy about how it went and who we worked with, and the arrangements that were made. Everything went smooth and was a great pleasure. There we go. We have Mr. Doug Harris with us. He's in the house tonight, and he offered his support on the project with his professional camera work, and so that was a real pleasure. And some of you know Marvin Collins, I'm sure, and he was a real pleasure to connect with. And if you would like to know more about what we do, or if you'd like to read the blog post about this project, you can see up here, fineartconservationlab.com, and then blog. It's the first one there. Also on YouTube, if you search with my name, there'll be all kinds of videos. I've got hundreds of videos available, and I try to keep them entertaining. And I don't think that you'll fall asleep. We constantly get good reviews. And then if you would like to go to Facebook, I accept everybody that wants to be a friend. And so you can just put my name in and you'll go to my Facebook page, okay? And then, I had to put in my political comment for tonight. That's on the wall in the museum. So save freedom of speech. And there you go. Okay, so I've got some things now that I would like you to, I'm going to blow through this quickly. As collectors and we all, whether we're art collectors or not, we have things that are near and dear to us and that we have that we've collected or inherited. And so I, years ago, wrote some books, Save Your Stuff books, that give people tips on how to preserve and protect what they own. And so one of the questions I get often is it worth it? Or, you know, what is the value of my item? As if some type of financial evaluation would make their effort to restore something, worth the effort. But of course, there are other considerations like, is it historically valuable? And is it emotionally valuable? And emotionally valuable and historically valuable really are what people mean when they talk about being priceless, because obviously a little while ago, I was in a bank vault with an $80 million painting, and it wasn't priceless. It was worth $80 million. So, but if you have a portrait of your grandmother, that's probably priceless because you can't get another one, right? So and the question about this mural, for instance, how valuable is this mural? Well, that's not a straightforward answer because it's got cultural and historical impact for the community. And so there's all kinds of other considerations. You might consider ancestors' portraits and the family Bible or love letters from your grandmother and grandfather in the Second World War, or your kids' drawings that you're getting in school now. I have some stuff that I collected from my kids when they were in school. I cherish them. They're fabulous. And of course, as an art conservator, I put them into folders and other things that preserve them, so they're still in good shape. These are the kinds of things that that I like writing about. I like talking to people about preserving these things because they really establish the legacy or the history of a family. We call them memory triggers because, you know, I have a friend of mine who she was one of nine children up in Calgary, Canada. And when her mother, when the parents passed away and everybody was, you know, and there were lots of people that wanted stuff, the only thing that she wanted was a little step stool about this big. And that was like worth nothing. And people were laughed at. I said, "Why in the world?" And she goes, "Well, you know, I used to stand on that and help mom make cookies." And that was like the best thing in the whole house. That was the most valuable thing. She'd spend $2,000 to fix and to maintain and keep that little step stool if it came to it. If she lost it in a fire or something, she would be devastated. More devastated than losing everything else that can maybe be insured. You can't insure something that is irreplaceable, of course. So, all of these things require some planning ahead, and I'm here to be your preservation coach, help you figure out how not to have it destroyed by water or earthquakes. We took a special step with your mural to protect it against future earthquakes. And there are things that you can do to protect books against handling. And I can't tell you how many unbelievable packing jobs I receive in the mail from people who ship artwork. I had somebody send me a painting. It was about this big, right? And I get it with no packing material in a FedEx box. And they don't tell me anything about it. There's no information about it. About 3 weeks later, the owner calls me up and he says it's a $3.5 million painting that he just bought at auction. I was stupefied. And so, people just don't engage their brain sometimes. So I'm hoping to give tips to remind, to encourage you to make some good choices for preserving your heritage or your legacy or to these memory triggers that enrich our lives, bring us together as families, bring us together, give us connections with other people. And if you think about it, you know, those are the things that you're going to take with you when you pass on, are those connections. All right. So here are some things that you can, that are important for you as let's call you a collector. Okay. A collector of your family heirlooms, your memorabilia, your valuable collectibles, your whatever your stuff, whatever stuff you have. I would like you to be able to recognize problems and then learn what not to do. And the do-it-yourselfers are horrible. You know, one of the worst group of do-it-yourselfers are sailors on boats, on ships. And since, of course, we're looking at a shipyard here and close to the ocean, close to the bay in Richmond, you know, sailors think they can fix anything. And so if they ever get a work of art or a collectible in their hands, it's, you know, it's game over for that collectible because they have no idea what they're doing. We get, you know, maritime paintings, a lot of maritime paintings were made to be carried on ships. And then when they got a hole in them or something else, you know, obviously they got fixed. And it's hard to get a good an old maritime painting in good shape because of where it's been, but also because it got fixed by sailors. Okay, anyway, you can learn what you can do. And then you need to know how you get support. Am I making you laugh, Melinda?
Yes, because we have a ship. We have a ship in our collection. One of those World War II ships is in our collection. Yes. So when
is it me? Are you trying to fix it?
Yes. Yes. So it's irony. It's irony that you said that. So thank you. Visit the Red Oak Victory. It's wonderful.
What's it called?
The SS Red Oak Victory ship.
The Red Oak Victory. How come you didn't take me down there?
I was distracted.
Next trip.
I'm with the Red Oak Victory, and we're going to reopen to the public November 21st.
Oh, right. Right.
Tuesdays and Saturdays.
And am I right that sailors and boat guys know how to fix everything?
I'm still learning.
Well, I'm going to try and teach you what not to do. And this is a good example. Here is a completely priceless scrapbook with baptismal certificates and, you know, things of kids growing up and whatever. And, you know, and they're just not being respectful of the value it has in the family history. And it gets, you know, hit with water and then it gets left wet and it gets moldy. I tell you, the mold was so thick on this thing that when I tried to open it up, it growled at me. All right. So irreplaceable. A lot of these extremely valuable items that we're talking about are irreplaceable and uninsurable. So they're worth your effort to try. Now, I'm not saying that everything you've got that's old is irreplaceable and uninsurable. What I'm saying is set some priorities. And let's say to get started, pick out the top five things that are most important to your family history and begin work on those. All right. Water, of course, a problem, not only because of the wet, but because of the mold growth afterwards. And when you have water stains on paper or on books or on fabrics, just remember you cannot fix that. So don't try it. Okay. If you're going to cause more damage as you try to fix something like this. Okay. Now this breaking apart of the paper is caused by the fact that there are impurities in the paper that make it super brittle. You cannot fix this. Do not take your masking or your scotch tape out and try to fix it. Do not try to read my lips. Do not fix this. Okay. Just put this in a page protector. Call Melinda for coaching. Call me for help. We'll give you some suggestions about how to protect it and what steps you can take. Okay. Now this, I'm not saying everything needs to be it needs to be taken care of. I mean, not everything at IKEA is going to be a family heirloom and be valuable. Now, if this was the chair that your mother sat in and nursed all of her babies, maybe it might be valuable to you. So you need to know what, you need to learn what is worth saving, okay? And then my mom, I wrote the book on how to put together an archival scrapbook. And then she thought that she would surprise me and do a scrapbook for me. And so she went out and bought a magnetic page scrapbook and put all my photos into these magnetic pages after I wrote the book on how to put together an archival scrapbook. Archival magnetic pages, don't use them. All right. So there is, now this is a tip that you can look at later. And that is, I have a page on my website called hangaframeditemsafely.com. Take a note and go look at that. And that is going to help you upgrade the way you hang the artwork in your house and your office by a lot. And I can't tell you how many items I get in the lab that have fallen off the hook and onto the figurine or onto the lamp or the corner of the end table or something or other. This has aggravated me so much that I was motivated to make a web page and give you all the instructions about it. I can't tell you how many paintings that are $250,000 in value and are hanging onto a plaster wall for dear life with a little finishing nail. Unbelievable. Okay. Hangaframeditemsafely.com. And this is for all you do it yourselfers out there. Okay. All right. So we looked at that paper item that I have busted apart because of the way it was made and with a 19th century picture. Canvas from the same time period has acids in it that make 19th century pictures from the late 1800s, very brittle. Very brittle. This picture probably had a little bitty rip in it. By the way, this picture is full size. This guy is as tall as I am. And he's 6 feet tall. And then as soon as they got their rip or their poke in it, they put it into storage and leaned some other stuff against it. And it just opened up and just ripped like crazy. And so you can see on the far right of this page, we can fix it. But, do you want to spend 10 grand to fix it? Just take care of it. And take care of your stuff. Okay, photoshopping and scanning your photography is something that I recommend that people do. Get it on the cloud. If your house gets blown to Oz, make sure that it's on the cloud and you got a copy of it. But that's not a technique for preserving the original. And even though you can make a copy, that doesn't invalidate the value of the original, okay? Just remember that. And another thing that you should be aware of is that a lot of times artwork or antiques have labels on them. And sometimes these labels can be really super valuable, not only in establishing the history, but also sometimes the value. This label made, I think, the difference of about $25,000 for the painting it came off of after we were able to decipher all the details on it and know more about where it came from and who it belonged to. This rip in the painting was caused when it fell off the wall when a sonic boom went over the house. That's how flimsy the nail was. And then this is something that's really interesting. This painting came to our lab for cleaning and it was in perfect, perfect condition. And I took it back to, we cleaned it and put varnish on it. And I took it to the owner's house. We put it on the wall. He lives in Emerald Bay in Laguna Beach. And then I came back like 2 years later and it was cracked to smithereens, just like this. I mean, I was dumbfounded. It had aged 100 years in 2 years. And I couldn't understand. And I looked around for, there weren't any windows. I mean, what was it? And then I looked up. And the heating and air conditioning vent was right above the painting. And it was blowing hot air, cold air. And that artificial aging, of course, aged it 100 years. So heat and humidity and temperature and all that kind of stuff. And those wide swings will age your antiques and art. Whoops. All right. What happened? Will age your artwork and antiques horrifically. And then just remember that all the things that you print out on your inkjet printer at home are not archival. Okay, the colors will fade, they'll run, the paper will turn brown, and those standards for what is archival and what isn't are set by the Library of Congress. And so you can read about those too. All right, so consider me your preservation coach. You can give me a call. I've written a couple of books to help you. The first one on the left was the one I wrote at the time of the Northridge earthquake. And there are four copies of this book at the museum that Melinda will be happy to sell you to benefit the museum. But you can also buy these on Amazon. And then this is our new book. And I wrote this during COVID, got it published. We even got an international award for it. And part of the motivation for, I mean, I love pets and we want to take care of our pets. And if there's an earthquake or some other, or even a car accident, you know, we want them protected and we want to take care of them. And you may have seen there with Melinda, her cat was walking around. Is that your cat there in front of you now? There he is. And so all these, you know, these fur babies need to be taken care of. You can't insure them. And if you lose them or they're damaged, then your heart hurts. So take good care of them. And we've got our award for the best pet care guidebook out there. And but we also have, one of the other motivations was that we always have stuff in the lab that's been damaged by pets. Where is it? This sweet looking dog put $3,500 worth of damage on a painting as she was driving away from San Diego to get away from COVID and get home before they quarantined her. And I just connected with a lady who's got a couple of parrots, and they got so scared in a storm that they just came unglued. And of course, everything around them that they're banging into is having a problem. So anyway, you can, again, find me on YouTube. You can also type into YouTube, Save Your Stuff on YouTube. There'll be some things there for you to look at. SaveYourStuff.com is a website with a blog that has lots of articles on things that can help you be more alert and attentive as a collector. And you're getting your information straight from the expert. All right, so I want you to consider the fact that you have the opportunity to contribute to preserving California history and your community's legacy. And I strongly encourage you to set a good example for kids and for other family members, and make it part of your family legacy to preserve, help preserve your community's history. And you can do that by talking to Melinda about helping to preserve and protect and restore the things that she has under her care. And that's a real opportunity for your family to participate in the upcoming generations of your community. All right. So I send out email tips every once in a while to people that to remind them why they've bought my books, or remind them to think good thoughts when it comes to preserving and protecting their collectibles. And I can put you on that list if you go to Save Your Stuff and you log in, or when you buy one of the books, then you can get a hold of me and do that. So this is something that I don't know if I told you I was going to do this, but this is an offer that I'm doing just for you tonight. This book, Save Your Stuff, Collection Care Tips, is only available as a digital download. It's 210 pages with 35 embedded videos in it. It's a Hollywood production, and it's at saveyourstuff.com. And if you go to Collection Care, and if you go to saveyourstuff.com and go to Collection Care Tips, you can log in and you can download that book. And then I will consult with you over the phone for as long as you like and answer all your questions, even in multiple phone calls. If you'll make a donation, if you'll make an offer for $100 to the museum, then go download this book and put me on your fast dial so that we can talk about all the questions that you have and all the ways that I can hold your hand as you're trying to work through your boxes of stuff, okay? But consider that the museum would love to get a call from you for that $100. All right. And I think I am at the end. I am done. I am